Welcome to May 24th. It's a heavyweight day today. We're going to cover a lot in this video. As usual, we try to cover as much territory as possible. So, in the mood of repentance, realizing we need to do our homework. This world, how do you characterize this world? I would say it's a place where the world does not want any teachers here at all. This is what I feel. In fact, they're pleading for no teachers. In fact, the problem that the world is screaming about is saying, you know, we don't want any more teachers. We don't want any more teachers. They're afraid. They're afraid. Why? Because they're not doing their homework. Nobody's doing their homework. And they do not want to be put to the test to find out they haven't been doing their homework. This is the mood that this dream of separation gives rise to. And so you think the world needs help, you come in to help, and the help that they want is they want help to block any teachers. It's like, just imagine a classroom of students, and they've rebelled against the curriculum, and none of them are doing their homework, and they all gang together and say, hey, you know what? If the teacher gives us the test, we're all going to flunk, and they'll know that we've been wasting our time, haven't been doing our homework. So let's gang up on the teacher and prevent the teacher from giving the test. And that becomes the purpose of the students. This like this world is that way. So I want to put the world to the test. Who's done their homework and who has not been doing their homework is the question. So in a mood of repentance, realizing we have a severe continuity problem, because we have been dreaming a dream of complexity and of levels, and that doesn't exist at all. And so how do you understand this? Well, this is where the homework comes in. Familiarity, continuity problem is a problem of familiarity, moving your comfort zone, and you have to do homework. The situation we're in requires that we do our homework. So how do we have a continuity problem, and the only resolution is the vision of oneness. So how do we get the vision of oneness? This is the question that immediately brings fruitfulness when we actually accept, okay, I have a severe continuity problem. The vision of oneness resolves this. Now, what is this vision of oneness? Okay, let me... There's an answer for that. Very simple answer. Let's say we fall asleep and we're dreaming. And we dream, well, how to say it? We dream of a deep, deep ocean. A deep, deep ocean. And we dream we're sinking down into this deep, deep ocean. And we've gone down so, so far. And we call this, at certain levels of the ocean, we feel we've gone into another level. Okay, we're at the surface level, and then we go down to the subsurface level, and then we go down to the mid level, and then the deep mid level, and then the deep level, and then the deep deep level. And there's all these levels to this ocean that we're dreaming of. So then each level we go into, there seems to be a vast expanse of complexity and levelness, shifting and changing complexity. And it, the whole thing is, you know, this vast ocean of complexity and levels. But from this, so from the standpoint, though, of truth, there's just this dream. There's just this one dream. Everything is at the level of the dream. Everything that happens in a dream is at the level of a dream. So if you see it that way, there's just this one level of the dream. And this is what's called the awakened state. For example, Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj was someone who was enlightened for sure. It's not always easy to determine who is and who isn't enlightened, but I would say in this case, that's a bona fide enlightenment. And It's very simple. The awakening is very simple. Everything is the level of dreams. So he says, look, it's very easy to function. There's no complexity, there's no difficulty. Just a vision of oneness, just a vision of one level. See, and then after that, you can even drop the whole notion of levels at some point. But for our standpoint, awakening is simply the vision of one level. We just see what is there, and we stop believing that we're seeing something that's never been there. All these levels of the dream are unreal, because the dream is just the level of the dream. It doesn't matter what all the content of a dream is. All the relativity of a dream is all at the level of the dream. So if you simply see that your dream, have been dreaming a dream, and this is just your imagination, this is a dream, there aren't any real levels, there is no real complexity at all. And that's the awakened condition. You realize there isn't any real complexity. It's just, everything is completely simple. It's just one dream, the level of the dream. All the relativity of the dream is at the level of the dream. Just one level, right here, now. And that's as far as it goes. That's the awakened state. It's the awakened condition. Anyone can do this. Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj was just an uneducated country bumpkin, a little street urchin, hustler in Bombay, selling cigarettes. But he awakened to the truth. He awakened to this. He found a guru. He went to see a guru. He went to see tested, and the guru says, "Hey, you know, there's the test." And he says, "Yeah, I want to take that test." And he spent time working on it, and then he realized everything in the dream is that just simply at the level of a dream. So any of us can do this. It doesn't matter what our position in life is or what our education has been. It doesn't make any difference whatsoever. The only important factor is, are we doing our homework to getting ready for the vision of oneness? Are we being persuaded? Are we being persuaded? We're almost persuaded, as the song, almost persuaded. Almost persuaded. Well, the only thing that's holding me back, I believe, is the world doesn't want me, doesn't want enlightenment, doesn't want to be tested. They do not. They hate the idea because they haven't done their homework. They're going to flunk. They know they're going to flunk. But that's a good thing, to at least realize that you're flunking, and said, "Wow, I've got an F in this. I'm flunked. So maybe I better start doing my homework." Whereas if no test is ever given, people are deluded, saying, "Oh yeah, no, we could pass that test like that, no problem. No reason to do any homework. Nah, we easy. That's test, easy test. We don't have to worry about that." Herein is the problem of the world. Is you have this whole world celebrating, thinking like, "Yeah, we're great, you know, we're great," but they refuse to take the test. They ignore the teachers, they ignore the test, they don't take it, they avoid it. That should tell you something. Someone who has done their homework is eager to take the test, say, "Yeah, I want to know where my weaknesses are." So they spend time as much as possible listening to the teachers, who will let you know, you still haven't passed. In a dream, everything is equally unreal. In a dream, everything is equally unreal. It's equally a dream. But when we're dreaming, we don't see that. We believe that there's all this complexity, and all this differentiation, and all these problems, and everything has to be fixed, and wow, it's so complex. But when we awaken from the dream, we realize everything was equally unreal. It was equally a dream. It was equally dream stuff, equally our imaginings, our fantasy. So there's just one level there, right? Equally so, equally just a fantasy. All this relativity in a fantasy was all equally a fantasy. With no meaning, no importance, no relevance to truth or oneness whatsoever. The denial of oneness has no relevance to oneness. So it doesn't matter, the complexity of the denial doesn't matter. It's simply at the level of denial of oneness. That's all it is. Now, it's interesting to note that in the dream of complexity and levels and such, there can be all sorts of dream events take place at different dream levels. And so sometimes we know that something's going to take place, and it doesn't take place at the level, dream level, where we're focused on right at this moment. But it could be taking place at the dream, some other dream level that in the dream seems to affect us at some point. So when we talk about various events that may take place, it is possible they are taking place, but at a slightly different level of the dream. That is very possible. But to sidestep the whole dream is our goal, is to recognize that all dream levels are equally at the level of a dream. And this is the vision of oneness, actually. The vision of oneness is what resolves our troubles. So all we are asked to do is to simply not see what was never there to see in the first place. So fly. Go away, fly. It's simply to not see what was never there. In other words, the levels of a dream were never real, meaningful levels. They weren't real levels. The complexity of a dream is not real, true complexity. There is no complexity. From the standpoint of reality, there's no complexity to dreams at all. None. Zero. Meaningless complexity. The complexity of a dream is only, this fly seems to be, is only at the level of dreaming. Is only relative to dreaming. It is not relate to reality. Only relative to dreaming. When you're unaware that you're dreaming. Other than that, has no meaning. The denial of reality has no meaning. But we can dream a dream of complexity to the denial. So we can have an extremely complex denial. And we can have a denial on many seeming levels. We are getting a constant stream of these old military airplanes flying over our house. This just started like about a week ago or so. Never had this before. And now all day long, these big military transport airplanes are flying over this completely new flight corridor. I said, what is going on? And this area has suddenly been invaded by flies, just like that as I was talking. So the dream is full of action. The denial, it's a dream of denial. Denial of truth is completely meaningless. So, but what we do is we try to make a complex denial. Very complex, with many, many levels, all this stuff happening. And then we're intrigued by that. And we say, wow, we're sort of intrigued by the potentiality of denial. It's an adventure for us, an adventure in denial. But the waking up is always the same, which is to say, there never was any complexity to denial. There never was any levels to denial. It was a dream of denial. But denial of reality is always totally nothing, totally meaningless. Right now, it's always meaningless. But we dream the dream of time and of space and of form and complexity and levels. But none of that is really here as far as it's all one level of dreaming. Now we don't have to get rid of all the forms, but we can see it. Many helicopters too right now. It's weird what's going on. We've had a huge upsurge in helicopters and military planes flying. It sounds like another. What is this? Hold on. So yeah, all day long this is happening. One after the other, one after the other. It's incredible. So hell's a poppin', actually. They're not just out joyriding. There's something that's going on. I don't know what. But to awaken from the dream, we don't have to get rid of the dream symbols. We just have to realize that all dream symbols are equally dream symbols. There's no levels, real levels, and there's no real complexity at all. To see that there simply is this dream, and everything in the dream is a dream, is part of the dream. There's no complexity to that realization. Totally simple. Truth is completely simple. It's even simpler than simple, because it just is. It's causeless, it just is. We don't have to determine in our thinking, well, what's the cause and what's not the cause. Isness is omnipresence. You can't say, well, okay, where is omnipresence and where isn't omnipresence? Now, omnipresence simply is. Everywhereness simply is. Truth simply is. Love simply is. Peace simply is. There's not somewhere where love is and somewhere where love isn't. There's no isn't-ness to is. So there's no levels to reality. There's no levels to isness. There's no complexity to isness. Only in denial is there a dream of complexity. But it's only a dream of complexity. A dream of complexity isn't complex. The fact that it's a dream, we can say, this is a dream. There's no complexity to that statement. This is a dream. No complexity. It's when we deny that we're dreaming, or when we say, well, the dream is going to become real, that we pay attention to the seeming complexity, we get lost in it. When we want the dream to be real and effective, and in order for us to believe denial can be effective, we have to believe in the complexity of it, right? Otherwise, we'd see there's no depth, no complexity, nothing to it, it's meaningless. So if we wanted denial to be effective, we get lost in this dream of complexity and levels. All morning long, there's just been a stream of planes. Here comes another one. I'll show you another one. Here it comes. I mean, it's like 2 minutes every, like, 2 minutes or something. What's going on here? You can hear them, like they're like a prop plane, you know? Like a sort of an older military prop plane. I see. Now that one took off in a slightly different direction. So because we want denial of reality to be effective, we as our desire for this, we believe the complexity is what we must have. We must believe in this complexity, that it's actually our actual levels, that they're meaningful differentiations. So we believe in a relativeness, duality. More and less. In other words, we don't believe in isness. We believe in becomingness, process, becoming. Numbers, variations, all this is dream. This is a dream. Why are we doing this? We want to be separate from God. We want to create separately from God. We want our creations to not know their creator. In God's creation, all creation knows the creator. And it's all one creation of the creator. And a co-creation. It's all a creation co-creation extending from the creator. What spirit wants to do is says, hey, how about we can create a separate reality where creation doesn't know its creator. And so we're believing that this dream of complexity and levels provides the ground from which can grow our creations, except they won't know that they're our creations, and then we'll feel that we're greater than God. This is what's motivating all this. But the trouble is, we're lost in this complexity and relativity and levels, thinking that we're lost in our thinking and figuring and adjusting and reacting to all of this. In a dream, it's all dream stuff, equally dream, imagination, fantasy. There's no reality to it. When we wake up from a dream and we vaguely remember all this different stuff that's going on in the dream, we wake up and we look around, pretty soon the whole dream fades away. We realize it's all faded away equally, with no residue really, and none of it was important. Similarly, this whole appearance of time, space, and form is a dream. Meaning, there isn't really any, there aren't any levels, real levels to a dream at all. So there's nothing, there's no relativity whatsoever in a dream, not any real relativity. So there's nothing that is relative to something else here. It's all one. This is what's called the vision of oneness. Is you see the perfect non-relativity of everything. The everywhere nowness of everything. Of everywhere. Everywhere. Everything is. Everywhere and everything is. And right now. The everywhereness. There's only this everywhereness with no relativity to any appearance or any place or any feeling of relativity. It's just this feeling of oneness. This is called the smoothing out of the dream, the awakening from the dream. There's nothing of greater or lesser value or importance. When Jesus says drop your valuing, well, if you see everything as equal value, that is dropping your valuing. It's the vision of oneness, where everything, everywhere, has the same value. And then from that standpoint, from there, it's possible to let go of perception altogether. But that's beyond what we need to consider doing. Flies are symbolizing that irritations. There's something going on at some level. You know, in the dream, there's always a lot of stuff going on, isn't there? Now, what we want to do, in spite of everything that is going on, in spite of everything going on, we want to take the test. We want to see, okay, where do we stand as far as sidestepping this, the madness of this dream? It is really madness. And it's funny, everything going on here, so much activity taking place around me, and I'm still saying, okay, now let's focus on, you know, we say awakening from the dream, but what Jesus says is dream a counter dream, a dream within a dream. It's a double negative, so to speak. The dream within the dream is the dream of oneness. The dream of oneness. Where you still see positioning and forms and seem to see, still be in time, space, and all of that. Yet you're seeing all of equal value. Which from the standpoint of value is really, the only value it is it solves a continuity problem. That's the only value. It solves a continuity problem. And then you can drop valuing altogether. Valuing has to do with form. So we don't need to awaken from the dream, so to speak. We need to see a dream within the dream. And this is a dream of equal value. So if I go to a teacher, I'd say, look, I'm flunking. I don't have the vision of oneness. Okay, so what do I need to, how can I be helped, my focus to, so that this can accept this? So we need to have a realization, we're flunking the test. So, you know, how can I work today to change that? The action of the dream is so fragmenting that we have a hard time focusing constantly on it, right? So I'm just showing, you know, not artificially contrived here, it's just real life, real action, what happens in the world here is there's all sorts of distractions, all sorts of things hit you. You know, and don't think, well, I'm only flunking because I don't have the right circumstances. I'm not in a cave in the Himalayas. That's why I'm flunking. So that's a cop-out. Whatever situation we find ourselves in, we have to do the best we can, right there, right now, right in those circumstances, to continually accept the vision of oneness, to dream within the dream. Wow, these flies. Not had flies before, they just suddenly appeared today. May 24th, the flies appear. The airplanes appear. The irritations appear. Flies, where they feed on death. Not a good thing for flies to suddenly appear. Now, in a dream, we have life, what we call dream life and dream death. Both are equally on the level of a dream, right? Dream life, dream death. Equally the same value. Value of a dream. What value does a dream have? That's the question. What value does a dream have? What value does dreaming have? No value. So it doesn't matter. The imaginary content of a dream doesn't make a dream any more valuable. What has no value cannot be made more valuable. What intrinsically has no value cannot be made more valuable. It's like a zero. You cannot make zero greater than zero. No matter, it's kind of like this dream is like multiplying zero by all these multipliers. And you say, wow, okay, now I'm going to multiply it by 10 trillion zillion, you know, years. I'm going to multiply zero time by, you know, trillions of years. And we can, like, say, wow, this is incredibly significant. And we say, well, I'm going to multiply it by less than that. And we say, oh, this is historic. This is very significant. We're now multiplying zero time by less than a zillion years. Now it's like 20 billion years. Wow. And they say, you know what? We decided something incredibly historic and important. We're now going to multiply time, no time, by 24,000 years. Oh, everyone says, oh my God, that is so incredible. It's so incredible what is happening. We're now multiplying it by 24,000 years. And before we multiplying it by a billion years, this is like super historically incredibly important. And the motions, you see, is this feeling of historic. The motions of like something important is happening, something historic, something amazing in the dream. Like, wow, we're adjusting how much we're multiplying zero by. Okay, now, I would suggest this. Instead of dropping the whole thing about multiplying zero time by something imaginary, don't drop that. Still keep it, but this is what we do. We multiply zero time by zero. Okay? Multiply zero times zero. Don't just say, I'm scrapping the whole thing. No multiplication of zero. I'm finished. Boom. That's where the continuity problem arises. So what we do is we multiply zero by zero. A lot of multipliers are coming up. Now just multiply zero by zero. See, for the rest of your life, all you have to do is multiply zero by zero. That's it. That's all you're called to do. That's passing. Anything else is flunking. Anything else is flunking. Just keep multiplying it by zero. the day and multiply zero by zero. That's the vision of oneness, actually. Zero complexity, zero relativity, zero duality. And yet, it's because you're multiplying it by zero, it's important to have all this stuff here so you can see, well, at least I am multiplying. I'm still multiplying. Okay, don't drop that, because then the continuity problem will jump up and bite you. So if you can feel that, hey, this is the answer, then you're very close. You're almost persuaded. That is a fact. Whereas if you say, oh, horrors, you know, that's a waste of time. Why would I want to waste time like that? Then, you know, you're flunking. Wow. What is that? There's so much activity going on in the air. Something just dropped, the pine cone, boom, there's something up there. Eating pine cones, birds are flying all the place, airplanes, flies, the cat is all restless. I mean, this is the most restless morning I can remember. And here comes another plane. Here comes another plane. Oh my gosh. What is going on? This is not a normal day. Let's check this out. Well, I couldn't find that plane, but we do have these hawks up here. Suddenly have appeared. You see these two hawks up here. Wow. Amazing what's going on this morning. So in spite of all the distractions, we've managed to get to this incredible point of let's multiply zero by zero. And people say, you're losing all relevance. No, the dream never had any relevance. So what we're doing is maintaining a semblance of relevance by continuing to multiply. So in the world, but not of it. We seem to be in the dream, but we're not of the dream. We're not trapped in the searching for relevance of the dream. We're not searching for irrelevance. We're just multiplying zero by zero. And so it's always zero, always zero relevance, and yet we continue to multiply by zero. So we were able to function here, seemingly. Not a problem. More pine cones going boom, like bombs dropping. Of course, the screeching of these hawks, those are sounds of war. The war planes, the flies, the pine cones going boom, the hawks screeching. Something's going on for sure. You can feel, I said 24 is a very important day. It's going to be a shift. As the dream's always shifting. Levels are always shifting in the dream. But when we keep multiplying it by zero, where's the shift? Is there any shift in that? No, but the plausible, you maintain a plausible presence here, okay, when you multiply, because you're still multiplying, but by zero. So a plausible presence is maintained here. But your state is now steady. It's steady, calm, peaceful. By any complexity. as people frantically rush around and emotionally driven for relevance. I say, oh my God, there's something incredibly relevant taking place here. You know, is the dream is constantly the turbulence of the dream. Denial has to always be in motion. It has to be. Right? Relativity has to always be in motion. Change is shifting. In order to think like it's relevant, there's something, because it's always this feeling of it's not relevant at all. And so we say, so we have to keep it going. So you say, well, yeah, you know, it's not relevant yet, but look at all this, you know, the mirage is constantly like a phantasmagoria. And so we're always thinking it's going to be relevant. See, I look at all the changes are happening, changes are happening, changes are happening. So it has to be a dream of change, constant change. Also has to be a dream of death, constant death. Because we want our creations to not know their creator. So we want that to be this separation take place, a separation. So we have to see things come to an end, come to an end, come to an end. It's like a hall of mirrors here. Hall of the dreams, like a hall of mirrors. Wherever you look, there's all these different reflections. We multiply by zero, multiply by zero, I'm multiplying by zero, multiplying by zero, multiplying by zero, I'm multiplying by zero. We can still have a semblance of thought, still have a semblance of relevance, still have a semblance of all of this, right? Because we're still, we say, oh, this is relevant. I'm multiplying by zero, that's relevant. I'm multiplying, and it's relevant. I mean, so there's a semblance of functionality. It's just everyone else is multiplying by something else, like 258. Oh my God, I just... And then now it's, whoa, it changes to 2 billion, 2,640,000, you know. Oh, I'm multiplying zero by that. Wow. You know, and then they're multiplying by something different. What's the relevance between they're multiplying it by this and I'm multiplying by that? And so, wow, this is really interesting relevance, but we seem to have a conflict because we can't quite agree of what do we multiply it by, but I'm intrigued by what they're multiplying zero by. And so let's talk about it, you know. You see how it can just be this endless fantasy of complexity, confusion, conflict, alliances, you know, about what do we multiply zero time by? All of it totally irrelevant, no meaning whatsoever. It's all still zero time. There's no such thing as time. So how do we multiply time when there is no such thing as time? And yet we're so used to multiplying that we're afraid to drop multiplying, so I say just keep multiplying, we just multiply by zero. So, it's really relevant, multiply by zero, cool. I multiply by zero again, same response, awesome. So this is a vision of oneness, I multiply again, vision of oneness. I keep multiplying, I keep getting the same result, this is really great. Wow, I keep getting peace. That's great. Same result, same result, same result, same result. I like this. This reminds me of something. Oh, it reminds me of freedom. Reminds me of no time. Which there isn't any time. There's freedom. Always freedom. So how can there be time? Which implies linked moments, linked choices that are somehow linked together out of necessity. There's no such situation in reality. Multiply by zero. And people say, well, what about me? How come are you not using my multiplication? Then I can help you out. I say, well, what about you? I suggest you multiply 0 by 0, 2. That's my suggestion. And they say, yeah, but we need relevance. We need to talk about I'm multiplying it by something different than yours. Why the difference? All I suggest is multiplying by 0. Not interested in something else. Because I admit I have a continuity problem. I do have a problem, you see. So it's not like, you know, the ones that are still multiplying by something else than 0, they refuse to admit they have a problem. Where I have admitted I have a severe problem, I have a continuity problem. So I'm in therapy. So I'm not at liberty to go run off and what about, let's try some other numbers, you know, for fun. Or so. I'm not at liberty because I've admitted I have a severe problem. And so I'm in therapy for that. And the therapist says, you got to multiply by 0. So I'm not the Holy Spirit says multiply by 0. I'm not a free agent at this point. See, so I'm admitting that I have a problem accepting my freedom. And so I've accepted the remedy of this. Like under doctor's orders. I'm under doctor's orders, really, to not multiply by anything other than 0. So there's all these people who might say, hey, come play with me, let's go play, let's start multiplying by different numbers and see what we can come up with just for the fun, the adventure. And I say, well, actually, I'm under doctor's orders and you'll have to talk to my doctor about that. But myself, I cannot choose that at this moment. Because I have a severe continuity problem. I need to resolve that first before I know how I really want to spend my freedom, you see. Because I realize I've misspent it very badly. I've tried to imprison my freedom. And then people say, oh, you're no fun. I say, well, you know, blame my doctor then. Don't blame me, blame my doctor. Doctor Holy Spirit. People are seeing this dream, they say, my God, this is so relevant. Could you believe it's like infinitely relevant? It's infinitely complex. Oh my gosh, we just can explore forever. There's the relevance. Yeah, but at some point, you just say, hey, you know what? I'm tired of this dream of time and space. And then you say, well, okay, I want to drop it. Then whoops, what's that? Then the continuity fear hits you. So you don't realize you have a continuity fear until you decide you want to drop this dreaming. And at that point, then you say, oh, I'm in big trouble. So it's easy for those who have not yet decided to drop this dreaming to pretend that they're, you know, lords of existence and they're all these hot shots, you know, that they're hot-dogging it all over the place, right? And they think the other ones who are saying, no, I don't want to go out and play that way, they think that they're somehow inferior. What's the matter? What's the matter with your spirit? How come you don't want to be adventurous and stuff? Well, see, that's where humility comes in at play. They just haven't realized they have a severe continuity problem because they haven't tried to set down the dream yet. So you try to set down the dream. I tried to do this when I was about, what, 20, 21 years old, something like 21 years old. I said, okay, I'm going to set it down now. I tried to do what Ramana Maharshi did, just set it all down. And this huge tsunami of panic, dread suddenly arose. I said, where'd that come from? Shocked me. I said, oh my God, I've got a problem. I can't just set it down that easily. Why? And why? And then the spiritual path, you know, became super intense. Maybe it's about when I was 22, about 1978. I said, holy cow, I want to set it down and I'm too afraid to. So there is this weirdness of the dream where those who are embracing the dream and relishing the dream and feeling they're getting something out of it, they seem to be, you know, the champions, the heroes, they seem to be very spiritual. Well, that's not the case. Is they still feel they're going to succeed at being able to create separately, have their creations that are unaware of the Creator. And so they're still doubling down. But this doubling down situation eventually you find yourself in total chaos. And then you say, wow, I gotta drop the dream. I have no choice. You eventually realize you have no choice but to drop the dream. That's what happened to me. And I said, okay, I gotta drop the dream. I tried to drop it. I said, I can't drop it because I have a continuity problem here. I got a fear. And the Holy Spirit says, okay, now you're ready for the path. It's like that. And the Holy Spirit said, you just got to be educated in what's really important. Get a Holy Spirit education, and you'll recognize, wow, yeah. When we put our creativity towards denying our freedom, we can really go on a long, strange trip. And the trip gets so strange that we get used to this strange trip, and we're afraid to drop it. We're afraid to drop the belief in time. We're afraid to drop the belief in time because we think time is what gives relevance and value to us. It somehow establishes an identity. Remember, we're trying to establish an identity which is unaware of its creator. So of course we're going to dream of a very strange, bizarre scenario where somehow identity was lost. And it gets so lost that we conclude it never was. See, we want to conclude that timelessness never was, that there's only time and time-space, that's timeless, spaceless, formless identity was actually a dream. So we're trying to dream a dream in which we feel reality is the dream, and this dream is the reality. So we're trying to act as if we believe that this dream is reality. So we're trying to enjoy the dream. We're trying to enjoy the dream. We're trying to act like, yeah, I just love this. This is my reality. I love this reality. So that then we can then conclude that reality is actually a dream. And so that our creations that we want to create in this dream will think that this dream is reality, and reality is a dream, and will not be able to know what created it. And then therefore we can think, look, we did something even God can't do. We created a creation that doesn't even know its creator, doesn't even know its true identity at all. It's like a mad experiment we're engaged in, but we don't realize that we're trying to make the dream real to us so that reality seems like a dream to us. And we can go down that road so far that when we decide to, wow, turn around and accept that reality is real and this is a dream, we have this huge fear like we're going to be annihilated, that we're going to lose our identity. Because really trying to make this dream our identity is an attempt to lose our identity. So we're so used to trying to lose our identity that when we feel like that not losing our identity would be losing our identity. You see how crazy it gets? And this is the situation we're in, which is why the spiritual path is necessary, which is to carefully, gently and carefully dissolve this fear, let the fear evaporate, and just recognize, wow, I've really been in a crazy situation here, upside down and backwardness. And because of that, it seems too scary to drop the multiplication altogether, to drop multiplication bringing value and depth, right? And seemingly time and space and all that. Except now we just multiply it by zero. So we say there's zero time, there's zero space, there's zero complexity. And yet, by saying there's zero time, we're still referencing time. By saying zero space, we're still referencing space. Saying zero form, they're still referencing form. By saying zero separation, we're still referencing separation. So as long as we still multiply zero by zero, we're able to reference all of time, space, and appearance and activity in time and space. we're able to reference it. We don't lose that as a reference. Now, ultimately, again, we go beyond that and don't have to reference any anymore. We don't have to multiply zero by zero. We don't even have to reference zero at all. Why would reality need to reference zero? Doesn't need to, does it? Why would everywhereness need to reference zero? Say there's zero non-everywhereness. See? Which is what we're doing. We're saying like there's zero non-everywhereness. I feel zero non-everywhereness. I feel zero time. I feel zero space. I feel zero form. I feel all this zeroness. So we're still referencing time, space, form, and zeroness, right? Which enables us to reference the dream. Truth is, God is not referencing this dream. Reality is not referencing this dream. The Holy Spirit is, though. God, it's a special creation of God to reference the dream, to say zero times zero, to reference zero. So don't be scared that you'll have no reference point. You'll still be able to reference. I say, oh, I'm referencing zero space, zero time. Oh yeah, I'm seeing zero time. I'm referencing zero time. And you say, well, you see lots of time. I see zero time. But we're still talking about time, aren't we? We're still referencing it. So we can communicate, we can talk. And help comes that way. Not only are we talking about zero time, we're talking about multiplying zero time by zero time. Because the activity of everybody is multiplying, multiplication, right? Replication, more and more and more. Let's multiply zero by, you know, this quantity, this value. It's by multiplying zero value by a whole bunch of value. So people want to... In order to relate to this world, you need to be able to say, well, I'm multiplying too. I'm multiplying zero value by zero value. So there is a relatedness. That's why gurus can appear. Saints, sages, gurus can appear here. And we can reference them. When they disappear, well, why? What happens? They just stop multiplying zero by zero. There's no zero, no multiplication at all. That's what. And they appear here by how? By multiplying zero by zero. That's how they appear. Enlightenment appears in this world as in the form of zero times zero. That is the form of enlightenment. So we can have that form, can't we? We can share that form. It's imminently shareable, is it not? It's the one form that all can share. If we all choose the form of zero times zero, what's that? Perfect oneness, isn't it? Where's the dispute? Where's the conflict? So all we're called to do is to see everyone as having accepted that they're the form of zero times zero. Because they will. Because everyone will accept that. And in fact, they'll accept it right now. Because all this multiplication of time which they're engaged in is a fantasy. The end point is right now, always. So it is possible to see everything. Everyone is already enlightened in the form of enlightenment. The form of enlightenment being zero times zero. Wow. I'm having troubles with this recording for sure. That's good. That means it's really okay. Something. Unbelievable. That's great, because this is the struggle that everyone faces, is it not? In this dream, there's constant activity and change and distraction is always going on. And the ego just tells us, hey, that's not fair. If you were really spiritual, you'd have a better situation for yourself. If you really could do it, the ego would say, God would have you in a better place. So you better wait until circumstances are better. See, this is the lie that we tell ourselves. Because we have a continuity fear. So we're not going to go to someplace better until we work on this continuity fear. So you have to work on the path where you are. That is the most important key for everyone. No matter where anyone is right now, they must work on the continuity problem. They must admit, say, I have a severe continuity problem. I can't drop this yet, the complexity and all of this. I feel value and meaning and my identity is all tied up in this. I believe I'm scared. In other words, don't fall for the ego's excuses. The ego will always make excuses for you why you don't need to do anything right now, why you don't need to work on this. Always. That's what it's for. Is this the excuse maker? It's like a handy excuse maker you have with you at all times. You say, I feel like an excuse. Boom, the ego gives you an excuse. Great excuse. You think, it's a wonderful excuse. The Holy Spirit will never make excuses like that. He'll say, see what you can do right now. Now, if you've placed yourself intentionally in a super intense distraction, the Holy Spirit will say, well, the first thing you need to do is back away from that a little bit. If you're like in some nightclub, strobing, people, wild people drinking, the Holy Spirit might say, hey, maybe you need to go outside. Maybe you need to go back home, like that. But you can also say, why am I doing this? Oh, okay. I feel something, continuity problem, vision of oneness. What is the vision of oneness? I forgot. Why am I forgetting? Oh, I'm all this distraction. Okay, so why is this distraction important? I have a continuity fear, so it seems to reassure me that all this complexity is valuable, right? Okay, and I just start working on it. So in my life, I've always been working on it. Never not been working on it. Because the Holy Spirit says, work on it. Come on, keep working. You can do it. You can do it. You can do it. Zero times zero. How hard is that? Zero times zero. What's the value of existence? Zero times zero. What's the form of existence? Zero times zero. What's the form of enlightenment? Zero times zero. See, everything, the everywhere nowness is zero times zero. The everywhere nowness is zero times zero, right? Nothing more to add about that, right? Nothing need to add or subtract. Can you add to it? Can you subtract to it? Zero times zero, what can you add to it? What can you subtract from it? Stable. This is the zero times zeroness. This moment is the zero times zeroness. This day is the zero times zeroness. The everywhere nowness. So what we want to be is we want to be a test to others to say, do you have zero times zeroness? Do you have the form of enlightenment? Now, let's say you are multiplying a billion times zero. And you say, I'm a billion years from realization. And they say, I need to do 999,999 times zero and then go down that way. So eventually, at first you'll say that. And the Holy Spirit says, hey, you know, a billion times zero is the same as zero times zero. So you're not a billion years away. If there's no time, how can you be a billion years away from no time? People say, well, it's scary. Okay, and the Holy Spirit will say, okay, be like 1,000 years away. You know, try that. Say, okay, I'm 1,000 years away. Then later the Holy Spirit says, try 100 years away. Say, okay, 100. So you've gone from a billion to 1,000 to 100. Like in, you know, short, I don't know how long, but it may take you a couple decades. Maybe now, after several decades, you're at 100. 100. Yeah, 100 times zero. Okay, I'm 100 years away from no time. And then the Holy Spirit says, how about 10? Let's try 10. So, whew, you know, 10, wow. And you're nervous at 10, and then you got to let that sink in. You're getting a little close, you see. I'm getting close to no time. I'm 10 times zero. And then the Holy Spirit says, how about a year? About a year away. Whew. Wow, I'm a year away from enlightenment. Zero, no time, okay. At least I got a year. How about a day? You know, a day. I'm a day away. How about a minute away? See, well, I'm a minute away. I'm a minute away. Okay. So, you see, that's the spiritual path. When we start out, we think we're a billion years away. And within the spiritual path, we gradually make these jumps because we realize something tells us, you know, hey, wait a minute. If there's no time, how can I be a billion years away from no time? Right? Something doesn't add up there. The Holy Spirit says, you'll get a better perspective if you say 1,000 years away. And say, okay, I'll do that. And so gradually you get this bit closer perspective, and then you're like a minute away. Another plane. But then the Holy Spirit says, look, you don't need to have enough time. You just need to multiply zero time by zero time. Don't stop the referencing. You don't need to stop referencing time. You don't have to stop multiplying. Just multiply zero times zero. So that's where I'm at. I'm getting used to that. Zero times zero. But it's been a progression of, you know, little less time. Maybe I don't need to use so much time. So when we start the spiritual path, it seems impossible. It seems ridiculous. Why would we say, I need to spend a billion years on the path? That's crazy, right? But we say we have no choice because we realize that this whole thing ends up in total chaos and we don't want it. It doesn't get us what we want. We cannot enjoy creation in total chaos, our creations not knowing their creator. We find out we cannot tolerate it. It's total chaos. So it's this is all just a futile endeavor. So we think a billion years, wow, never gonna make it. But we say, well, I might as well just got nothing else to do. Might as well poke around at this. Maybe I can speed things up a little bit. I don't know. It starts like that. And you can't help but be glum as you go along because you say, well, this is ridiculous. I'm on a path too. This is going to take so long. It's crazy. But the Holy Spirit tells you, don't worry. You'll find shortcuts along the way. You'll find shortcuts. There's shortcuts. So you keep looking for shortcuts. So certainly those who say you need to take a spiritual path, at first they sound crazy, right? Like you're being asked to do something that is just onerous difficulty. But look, they said, don't worry, there's shortcuts along the way. You will find shortcuts, for sure you will, without question. Everybody will find shortcuts. It's intrinsic to the path. The Holy Spirit is the shortcut master saying, hey, you know, you don't really need a billion years, do you, to realize there's no time. How about 100 years? And you'll say, okay, yeah, I can kind of see that. That's okay. It gives me, it's still, that still gives me a buffer, you know, so the continuity fear doesn't bite me too bad. And as the continuity fear evaporates, you realize you need less and less time to, you know, to realize there is no time. And now we get the zero times zero formula, which is, you know, fantastic. And the ones who have appeared here as zero times zero say, there's nowhere for me to go. There's nothing, nowhere to go, no one to see. I'm everywhere. I'm everything. Everything is me. It's all just one form of zero times zero here. Everywhere is the same. Zero times zero. Everyone is the same. We all have the form of enlightenment. They see us all with the form of enlightenment. Because that's the ending of the dream for everyone, is the same, zero times zero. It's the same, right? Exactly the same ending for everyone, zero times zero. Maybe some hold on to that for a while, some hold on to it maybe quickly, zero times zero, very quickly, drop even zero in times multiplying zero. But it's still the same ending for everyone, is they recognize it, zero times zero. To reference the world at all, zero times zero. To still have an appearance here, an enlightened appearance, zero times zero. So, see everything as zero times zero. See everyone that way. Reassure them that this too is their, this is their setting down of the dream too, is the same. You don't have to, we don't have to see anyone in time. We can see them as zero times zero. We don't have to see them as a billion years removed from zero, because they're not. They're not removed from zero at all. Because there is no time. So how can anyone be removed from no timeness? How can anyone be removed from everywhereness? We're all still within everywhereness, timeless everywhereness, timeless, spaceless, formless everywhereness. We never left. So why do we need to see one another as having left that? No one's left. We're just, many are having a fantasy of having left. You can reference the fantasy as by zero, by zero, zero times zero. That's the only appropriate way to reference it. We can say zero times zero times zero times zero. As far as your mind, what you're thinking about, zero times 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 zero. So you can still think, there's still thought, it's times zero, zero times zero times zero times zero. This is times zero, this times zero, times zero, I'm time zeroing. Infinite progressions, times zero, times zero, times zero. Sure, let it infinitely expand, times zero, times zero, times zero. If the thoughts want to run away, let the thoughts run away with times zero, times zero, times zero. Let all thoughts that come to me be times zero, timed by zero. Multiply them by zero. Everything that appears, multiply it by zero. And continue to multiply by zero. which means it still must be arising for you, right? Still referencing it. We're not zeroing it out, we're multiplying it by zero. So it's not going to disappear. How can something disappear if you're multiplying it? I'm multiplying the sidewalk by zero. So I need a sidewalk there to multiply it by zero. This moment, is it? That is for sure. Maybe the Holy Spirit will say, hey, I'm going to send you to some other place. It's possible. There are questions that arise. We don't need to jump into all of those questions, really. Just times those questions by zero. So each form that you see zero value as that form. But you're seeing the value of zero value. The value of zero value. Vision of oneness, value, seeing the value of no value. So everything becomes a beautiful reflection of no value. A beautiful evidence of no value. A So our true identity is free of all valuing. Valuing as form becomes of a evidence, wonderful evidence of no form. As if to say, hey, this too has no form. This tree will say, this too has no form. This too is everywhere nowness. This too has the feeling of everywhere nowness. This too has a feeling of everywhere nowness. So everywhere nowness has all these flavors to it. Zeroness. So, let's say we're 1 second away from this realization. Is 1 second away any different than a billion years away, if there's no such thing as time? The answer is no difference at all. 1 second away is the same as a trillion years away. Multiplying zero times one is the same as multiplying zero times a trillion. The problem with any number is, where do you get the value for that number? You're valuing time. Valuing what doesn't exist. Valuing our own death. Valuing denial of our identity, which is formless, timeless, spaceless. So even being a second away has no value to that. Is if we tried to make it relative, well, I'm way better than a billion. Wow, unbelievable morning. All sorts of power equipment, cars burning out, helicopters, warplanes, hawks, flies. Just a tumultuous morning for sure. There's no value in valuing seeing value. There's only value in not seeing value. And ultimately we see that the double negative can be just dropped altogether. But for the sake of continuity, we need the double negative. Now this is what was shown to me in a dream. Night before last, I believe. A dream of enlightenment. I had a dream of enlightenment, and it was this double negative. Zero times zero. The value of no value. The value of no value. That is the form of enlightenment. So surely everyone can realize at some level, like, not level, but it's realize, have a feeling, at least a faint feeling, that, yeah, that this is it. Intuitively, you know, this is it. There is a form of enlightenment. Big relief, big relief. We don't have to drop form altogether. We can have the form of enlightenment. The value of no value. The zero times zero. Now, one might say, well, zero times zero, I can't derive value from that. Well, the valuing of no value. You can't derive value from seeing no value. The value of dropping value. And some will say, I need to derive value from multiplying zero by 1,000, you know. I need a lot of time. Time is value, you see. But there is no such thing as time, so how do I can't get value that way? Can't get value anyway, really, except the value of no value. In setting it down, there's value in setting it down. It's the only value that the belief in time has is the value of setting down that belief. I've had many, many dreams of enlightenment recently. It's just so. All this earthquake preparation seems to have temporarily kind of. It's been quite a strain. It's more than earthquake preparation, actually. It's disaster preparation. It's catastrophe. The world is, boiling. The effort to bring, to make value, make the dream real and reality a dream. In order to make the dream, try to make the dream real, has to get very intense. Has to have a lot of forgetfulness of reality. Has to have a lot of suffering, sickness, death, confusion, mental agitation. Of conflict. See, conflict makes denial seem relative, like value, like has some value. Like, whoa, there's conflict. So whoever wins, there's value is being conflicted here, and the winner will establish value. So it seems like when we want to establish value of this dream, more and more conflict arises, more and more trouble arises. It's like one says, I'm multiplying zero by 20, you're multiplying zero by 22, let's have a big fight, and the winner is right. See, and we'll winner, see, oh, 22 is the value now. Okay, we've got value now. Or we say, okay, one's 20, one's 22. Okay, let's compromise the kind, gentler, inclusive, nice, compassionate approach, right? Okay, you say multiply zero by 20. They say multiply 22. You have this big fight, competitive fight. Bad boys, very bad boys. Let mama fix it for you. How does mama fix it? We're going to decide on 21. All right, 21 times zero has value. Miracle. Mama has saved the day, you see. That is existence, is it not? And then when that fails, of course, you say, wow, I still feel that reality might be real. We're back to the fight between 20 and 22. Mama says, you know what? I think it might be a good idea for you to hash it out. Time for you to hash it out. Let's get a winner here. And so until the fight, 20 and 22 fight. And then again, Mama comes and says, you know, boys, that's enough fighting. I've decided to impose peace upon this situation. We're going to decide on 21. 21 times zeros it. And so for a while, you go with that, and then still reality seems real. And says, wow, I'm scared. I don't want to, I've got a continuity problem. And the mama says, boys, it's time to hash it out again. Let's finally come up with a winner here. Okay, 20 and 22, fight is on again. And then after a while, mama says, hey, boys, I'm on peace now, so we're going to decide on 21. 21 times zero is it. And this is just existence goes on and on and on and on and on and on like this. Mama says fight, mama says compromise. Mama says fight, mama says compromise. There's no end to that, is there? Until enlightenment, form of enlightenment, you listen to the form of enlightenment, which is zero times zero. Whatever place, time, body, whatever it's, whoever, the form of enlightenment is zero times zero. Whether it's this teacher, that teacher, that teacher, this place, that place, it's all the same, zero times zero. You can't keep listening to mama, because that doesn't work. That doesn't work. But we hear mama knows best. Oh, you, what you get with that is, boy, it's time to fight, boy, it's time to compromise, boy, it's time to fight, boy, it's time to compromise. Mama doesn't know best. The Holy Spirit knows best. The Holy Spirit says zero times zero. The Holy Spirit says zero times zero. Mama never says that. She wants to, Mama wants to come up with value, wants to this to succeed. She's trying to figure out, how can we make this succeed? Oh, we need a winner. Oh, now we need a compromise. Now we need a winner. Now we need a compromise. That's duality. That's insanity. That's exist. That's the dream. The voice of Mama, that is the voice of the ego. The Holy Spirit is the voice of God. The Holy Spirit says zero times zero. Sometimes if zero times zero appears in a female form, everybody wants to call her mother, 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 mother. But she will say, the zero times zero will say, no, 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 no. I'm not your mother. I'm zero times zero. So don't look at me as mother, because that's not it. Because what people want is the mother to decide these conflicts. Mother, should we fight, hash it out, or should we compromise? That's the parameters that people in the dream are thinking. And they say, Mother, just tell us what to do. Should we fight and get a winner here? Get the boys fighting? You know, Mother can easily get the boys fighting, right? So if the mother said, you know what, boy, it's time to fight. Go at it. That's the answer now. No more compromise. Fight happens. Mother says, you know what, boys, I'm tired of this fighting. It hasn't solved the answer. So we're going to compromise. This is where we're at. The boys stop fighting. It's like that. So the people in this world are looking for a mother, 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 to tell us, well, should we fight or compromise? The Holy Spirit says neither one. You take zero times zero. So zero times zero, whether it appears in a male body or female body, is neither male nor female. It's zero times zero. It's the form of enlightenment. There's no fighting and there's no compromising. Neither. There's multiplying zero by zero, the value of no value. Seeing the value of no value, the everywhere nowness of zero times zero. So I say, boys, you gotta leave Mama out of this, most definitely. And Mama, you gotta leave the boys out of this, you see. Whoever you identify with, the Mama or the boys, you gotta leave both out of it, right? You got both. The Mama's gotta go to zero times zero. The boys have gotta go to zero times zero. The boys gotta stop listening to the Mama, and the Mama's gotta stop trying to tell the boys what to do. See, both of that has to subside. Wherever you are, whatever role you're trying to play, go to zero times zero right now. So zero times zero is where in time? Is how much time is that? Zero times zero. So does the mind need to figure out how much time that is, or say it's right now? Does the mind need to figure out, well, where is that? Zero times zero in space? Where is zero times zero space? Isn't it right here? And zero times zero time, here, so here now, be here now. So zero times zero is not a compromise, but it is a referencing. And all we need to solve the continuity problem is a referencing. Okay? We don't need compromise, we need referencing. This is very important. Because the duality of the world will always say that you're either compromising or fighting. And if you're not compromising, you're fighting. And if you're not fighting, you're compromising. Whereas the Holy Spirit says neither. You're referencing. You're referencing the sidewalk. This is a zero time zero space sidewalk. Zero times zero. Zero times the sidewalk. This tree. This tree times zero. You're referencing everything, everywhere, as zero times zero. Which enables one to communicate here and function here. Referencing has nothing to do with compromise or fighting. So it's non-dualistic. So I'm going on this extended taping here because it's May 24th. Very important. Now, last night I was finishing up my preparations for disaster preparations. Very intense efforts, and got to the last place, stopped, looked, I noticed something in the odometer readings and everything, and the clock said it's 9:11, clock said it's 9:11, I said, okay, 9:11, and I looked at the trip odometer, which I had, and it was 1111, 9:11, 1111. I said, whoa, this is very interesting. And so I was thinking, what does it mean? What does it mean? What does it mean? Well, 9/11 means, of course, disaster, false flag disaster, terrible turmoil, crossroads. You know, 9/11 was the crossroads, plunging this world into the direction that it's gone now. So an extremely bad event in terms of distraction. So, extreme distraction. 9/11 means extreme distraction. What does the 111 mean? A vision of oneness. So it's saying, shown, the remedy for this extreme distraction is the vision of oneness. That is the remedy. And what is a vision of oneness? Zero times zero. All praise to zero times zero. You can feel the 9/11 feel of the day, can you not? It's just like popping all over today. Wow. Everybody's in a rush. You can feel the intensity of the way people are driving today. And I just, you know, wow. The whole day, it's a 9/11 type of day. Meaning severe distraction. Plunging you into trying to value, determine value. Reference the dream. That's all. Reference it as zero times zero. Will zero times zero show up with this form? I don't know. Will this form function as zero times zero? I don't know. That too is zero times zero. Show up where? Yeah. Where can it show up? Where can zero times zero show up? But pragmatically speaking, I don't know. But the responsibility of each one of us is to accept the form of enlightenment, zero times zero. It's everyone's responsibility. There's nothing greater than that here in this world. Don't worry about going beyond that. That happens automatically of itself. God actually takes the final step, the Holy Spirit has said. Takes the final step itself. The isness takes that. So there's no No worry about levels. Don't worry about levels. Just accept the form of zero times zero. The form of everything is zero times zero. So it's not, will everything, will this body show up as zero times zero? Will everything show up as zero times zero? Everywhere, everything show up as zero times zero. Will there be a universe of zero times zero presented into this dream, you see? Zero times zero. Well, there's still a lot of fear here. There's still a lot of fear. It's just all bubbling up. You know, you just say, okay. So, who knows? Who knows how deep the fear goes? But let that be the final adventure, is zero times zero. Everything is zero times zero. Let that be the final adventure in time, space, and form. It's. I've given up trying to predict what's going to happen in my life or anyone's life in particular. There's a lot of stuff happening in the dream, you know, that can appear here and there and there. Will it appear in a way that we see this feels like is concrete? I don't know. I really don't know. But I'll keep on clarifying, keep on clarifying, keep on clarifying like this. There's still something to be worked out. But maybe it'll just evaporate. Times that, times zero, too. It's better to do spiritual practice than it is to think. You start think, that you have a problem. It's better to have some sort of spiritual exercise you can do that you repeat and get used to it. So it becomes your natural reference point. Okay, I'm going to get about the day. Zero times zero. Just let that permeate, let everything evaporate. Permeate, evaporate. Zero times zero, permeate, evaporate. When doubts come, just say, no, permeate, evaporate. Zero times zero. Yes. Permeate, evaporate. Okay.